Have you been waiting for a show that gives you the real news you need to know? Have you been waiting for a show that reports the truth and isn't afraid to call it as it is? I've been waiting for that show too, and it's not coming from the mainstream media. It's not coming from the bought and sold corporate media. It's not coming from the news networks that only look out for profits and their bottom lines. They all speak through filters. That's why you need filter-free news. That's why you need filter-free radio. Filter-free radio is your new news headquarters for exactly what's going on and just exactly what we need to do about it. We must move forward. Move forward with us. Filter-free radio, live Mondays 7 to 9 p.m. Eastern on the Ustream home of Nicole Sandler, radioornot.com, and the all-new filterfreeradio.com.
This is Jackson Brown, and you're listening to the Nicole Sandler Show.
This is Melissa Etheridge, and you're listening to my friend, Nicole Sandler.
Hey, this is Rob with Matchbox 20.
Hey, this is Chris Isaac.
Hi, this is Suzanne Vega.
Hey, this is Trey Anastasio, and you're listening to
my friend, Nicole Sandler.
Bare Naked Ladies, you're listening to Nicole Sandler.
What's up? This is Howie Day, and you're listening to Nicole Sandler.
Hey, this is Henry.
And I'm JoJo.
And I'm Ringo.
And we're Lost Lonely Boys, and you're listening to Nicole Sandler.
This is Kelly from Stereophonics, and you're listening to Nicole Sandler.
This is Evan Dando of the Lemonheads, and you're listening to Nicole Sandler.
Hi, my name's Jonathan Brook, and you're listening to Nicole Sandler.
This is Pat Monahan from the band Train, and you're listening to Nicole Sandler.
This is Ziggy Marley, and you're listening to Nicole Sandler.
Hey, this is Pete Yorn, and you're listening to Nicole Sandler.
The lovely Nicole Sandler.
Nicole Sandler. Nicole is awesome.
The Nicole Sandler Show at RadioOrNot.com. Music to my ears.
You're listening to WIN, the Workers' Independent News Service. I'm Jesse Russell. While President Barack Obama may have received the most headlines from his speech at the United Auto Workers Conference last week, he wasn't the only one receiving applause. One of the most outspoken members of the Occupy movement, Jesse LaGreca, spoke on a panel and addressed the need for unions to get outside of their safety zone and get out and talk to people who aren't in a union.
It's so important to go to the people who aren't in the labor movement and explain to them, you know, when we do better, you do better too. When my neighbor's home is protected, my home value goes up. I know this is hard to understand for some people, but it's pretty obvious. So we need to look in that communal sense that we're all part of one great community.
LaGreca, who writes as Ministry of Truth at DailyCoast.com, became one of the many faces of Occupy Wall Street when he appeared in a Man on the Street video clearly articulating the demands of the 99%. He echoed those statements while speaking at the conference.
What we're looking at right now is the total repeal of the 20th century, tearing down everything working class people have fought for, we've been beaten for, we've been arrested for. All of these rights, they want to take that away. So the easiest thing you can do is literally go into your communities and express to them the values that you hold, that I care about my country and I'm here to fix it.
He told the audience that there is a very simple first step when it comes to starting change within the country, voting.
The only way that we can counter the corrosive power of corporate funding and democracy is to get our boots on the ground. That's the only way to do it. So if you want to win this fight for the future, you have to show up in November. It's your absolute duty. But above and beyond that, also explaining to other people why you're so passionate about this.
While encouraging people to vote, LaGreca also told the conference that the candidates they elect matter more than the party they are in.
I think it's so important that we elect politicians who are going to work for working class people, not for the special interests that own them. And if we start there, that's where the future begins.
The Republican Party could be single-handedly starting the fourth wave of feminism in the United States. On Friday, faced with legislation on both national and state levels intent on rolling back gains women have made in equality over the last century, an unprecedented number of organizations announced they would be uniting to form the Her Votes Coalition. 51 national women's organizations are taking part. They said the goal of the new coalition is to protect the gains women have made in the workplace, healthcare, education, and basic individual rights, and to continue moving forward an equality agenda.
Workers Independent News puts workers and their unions on the national radio news airwaves every day.
You've been listening to WIN, the Workers' Independent News. For more information, visit laborradio.org.
Come experience the next generation of progressive voices. Weekday nights on Nicole Sandler's primetime lineup at RadioOrNot.com. Liberate yourself with Filter Free Radio, hosted by Jacob Dean every Monday night.
It's just the system is broken. Bring it down. Bring it all down, right?
On Wednesday nights, take a sharp progressive turn and join Talking Left with Danielle and Shano.
All those Republicans are anti-capitalist.
All of a sudden. Well, no, they're just anti-Romney.
Exactly.
and it's interesting to watch the three-legged stool splinter.
Then let it all hang out both Tuesday and Friday nights on Turn Up the Night with Kenny Pick.
You love the Constitution so much, but you hate the government, but you love the corporations. Where does that come from?
Tune in to the primetime Radio or Not lineup weekday nights at the Ustream home of Nicole Sandler, RadioOrNot.com.
I'm sorry, I just find the whole thing so ironic and so mind-bending, it's just ridiculous.
Looking for filters? Check your coffee maker. This is Filter Free Radio with Jacob Dean and Skeptical Scott. FilterFreeRadio.com. Get ready to suck down some grounds.
When I talk about resistance, I think we have to stand up now and carry out acts of nonviolent resistance.
Because the truth is, we do have power.
We live in revolutionary times, but the counter-revolution is winning.
Sounds like a case of the Monday.
Live every Monday, 7 to 9 p.m. Eastern, Filter Free Radio.
This is my favorite show.
We have been given an opportunity to make a new beginning.
I think it's very important for us to start to build a culture of resistance because what we're doing isn't working, clearly.
It's our job to very coldly assess reality and then figure out how to respond.
Your number one source for unfiltered truth, analysis, and solutions. FilterFreeRadio.com.
And welcome, my friends, filter-free truth seekers. Turn off that television. Ignore the Rush Limbaugh reality show. It's as relevant to your life as the gossip on Jersey Shore, and voting in American Idol does not count as voting. The real debate raised by the Occupy movement about inequality, corporate domination and corruption, the security and surveillance state, this is the only debate that matters, and you will not hear it on corporate-owned airwaves. You will find it in the corners of the internet, though, but you do have to go looking for them. And welcome to Filter Free Radio. I'm Jacob Dean. We are joined by, as always, my super fantastic mass producer, awesome co-host and official producer of Filter Free Radio, Mr. Skeptical Scott.
Hello.
How's it going, Scott?
Not too bad.
You're just going to make it all the way through the whole show without talking.
That's always been the goal.
And we're joined by the fantastic hosts of Talking Left, the website talkingleft.com, and follow them on Twitter at Talking Left. Shano and Danielle are with us all evening this evening.
I don't have cool drops to introduce myself, so I'll just say hello.
Hello.
I don't even have cool drops to introduce myself.
I know, we need drops for people.
This microphone smells like beer.
Yes.
There you go.
That's my favorite one. That's my favorite one.
Good news, everyone.
Yes, good news, everyone. Indeed, big shout out to our friends and folks at ProgressiveBlendRadio.com. Our good friend DJ Downtown is working with all the shows on Radio or Not and building a fantastic relationship between the two websites, and has been on the air doing progressive radio from Washington, D.C. for 7 years. Been around the block a few times, and he knows what he's doing. So again, DJ Downtown, ProgressiveBlendRadio.com. Big shout out, tip of the hand, and happy Monday, man. Hope all is well on your end.
He's the host of the More Me show on Sunday evenings.
And you can watch some of the episodes. Recent episodes are on the video part of Radio or Not, which is awesome. And
what video part?
You go to RadioOrNot.com or on the Ustream, and you click on the videos where you can view all of the most recent episodes of Filter Free Radio, of Turn Up the Night with Kenny Pick, of Talking Left with Shano and Danielle, of soon USA Progressive with Ray Medeiros, and now with episodes of The More Me Show, of course, DJ Downtown, Progressive Blend Radio. That's all at the videos page on the Ustream of Radio or Not.
And at some point,
Scott.
It's going to be enough that it'll take us an entire show just to do all the plugs of the different affiliates and things. Like, have you realized this one, Jacob?
Wow.
Yeah.
There was an ad I don't know. This is kind of small news. I read about it this morning in the freebie paper on the Metro here in D.C. That there is an ad at a Washington, D.C. Metro stop, and I will read you the text of the ad. It's just a plain white background with really bold black lettering. That's two sentences, and then there's one sentence all the way at the bottom with a period. And it's the ad simply reads, Barack Obama wants politicians and bureaucrats to control America's entire medical system, period. And then the sentence separated down at the bottom says, go to hell, Barack, period. And this ad, as you could imagine, is stirring the pot a little bit in Washington, D.C. The actual chief executive CEO of Metro, it was, quote, deeply offended by this controversial ad that was posted at the Clarendon. Am I saying that right, Scott?
Clarendon Metro stop.
Clarendon Metro stop. I'm almost familiar with all of them.
That's in Virginia. You never go there.
Right. And
it's on the Orange Line, man. You don't ride the Orange Line.
I don't, but I got it right, though. And so we try to check our facts and stuff, and we do our best to present everything that we know to be true. And anyways, but it's at the Clarendon Metro stop, and the message, he says, the reason that it's still up is because it's not scheduled to be brought down until March 11th.
Because they paid for ad space.
Because they paid for ad space, pay to play. And he wrote this in an email. He sent it out to the entire Metro staff. There's 11,000 employees. And he writes, quote, like many of you, I'm deeply offended by this ad. Views and opinions expressed in this ad are not endorsed by Metro, and they do not represent the views of the agency. End of quote. And then apparently Metro contacted the advertiser, the person who bought the ad. These people are Free Star Movie LLC out of Los Angeles, Free Star Movie LLC. They paid $800 for the ad, and it's been running since mid-February. It runs for 1 month, mid-February to mid-March. And the reason that I wanted to mention that is not only because, I mean, it's actually making, you know, headlines in local paper in Washington, D.C. I saw it on the news. I asked Tom, have you heard about this? He's like, oh, yeah. And I just thought, is there a line? I mean, is there a point when an ad is so offensive that no matter what the contract or what they paid for the ad or something, there should be some way to go about having a process maybe voted on to have it reconsidered and refunded or something like that? I mean, is there a line here?
Well, as much as I would like to personally think that there should be, there can't be, for the same reason we were all discussing that it's not fair and it's not right to block political protests near an elected official or a political official, however that was precisely worded. But right, it's right. Political speech. As much as we disagree with it, we have to protect that political speech, which we can't stand and we find offensive. Otherwise, you face the slippery slope of having your own political speech be limited.
There is a line. By the way, Metro Transit, is that publicly owned? Is that, you know, a governmental entity? And therefore, you definitely can't. The only line there would be if it gets into something that would be considered, you know, pornographic, you know, not suitable for public, you know, consumption type of thing. So that would be the only line if it went past.
The article ends by saying Metro, quote, did not decide to accept this ad for reasons of revenue. Rather, we cannot reject it because the courts have ruled that the Metro advertising program provides a public forum protected by the First Amendment of the U.S. Constitution, end quote. Freedom of speech, pay to play, absolutely. And so I just wanted to mention that because I don't know if that story is circulating outside of D.C. at all. But
I've heard it.
You know, it's just... This is what we're seeing. We're seeing the progression of filthier and filthier and nastier and more vicious advertising. I mean, I used to watch The Simpsons religiously growing up, and I watched, and then of course, you know, I hit high school and college and was working and school and everything, and I kind of checked out of The Simpsons for a few years, and I've recently gone back and watched recent episodes. And it's really edgy. I mean, they say words now. They use words that they never used in the first 10 seasons of the show. And I'm just noticing society and culture in general is becoming ever more so tolerable, you know, or is tolerating more and more and more.
You're saying art imitates life?
Right. Yeah, those words. Words to that effect. But anyways, I mean, for what it's worth, I just thought that was interesting. And that's what they're doing.
Also, okay.
Okay. The Jacob Dean drinking game. Is that what that is? Scott Knight was...
Yeah, they'll do that.
He was making fun of me one day because I said, okay, like four or five times in a row, because I have a tendency to say that when I think I'm on a really good point. And I'm like, yeah, really good point, okay?
Okay.
And I did like four or five times in a row. And he's like, okay, that's another drink. But anyways.
And now I have a drop.
And now he pulls it on me all the time. And I try not to say it anymore unless I was referencing it or making fun of it.
My favorite is when I drive you off track.
Oh, I'm sorry. Did I break your concentration?
I was like, ooh, squirrel. You know? Other goings-ons in the area, down in Virginia, where I never go on the Orange Line, they were trying to... You probably heard about this bill. Maybe you heard about it on Saturday Night Live or The Daily Show or everybody else in the world making fun of this. Or not rather making fun of it, but, you know, just highlighting the disastrous, horrific... the ultrasound bill that was trying to make its way through Virginia. Of course, the governor, Bob McDonald, hasn't signed it yet. And over the weekend... on Saturday, a women's rights activist group organized a rally, and there were about 900 people at the rally. But Washington Post estimates 850 people at the rally. Some were saying a little bit more, some were saying a little bit less. But around 900, almost 900 people were at the rally, which is huge. I mean, Virginia's really red. It's a red state. And the legislature that was... You know, trying to push this through. They've introduced many of these bills just similar to this in the past, and they've all failed. You know, bills related to women's reproductive issues. You know, and they had a permit. The activists this weekend had a permit to protest, but 31 of them were arrested for trespassing or unlawful assembly. And, of course, in the first hour, we were talking about the crackdown, federal, you know, law crackdown on protesting. Republican Governor Bob McDonald of Virginia, Republican Governor of Virginia, hasn't signed the bill, which was originally supposed to include a vaginal probe requirement. They've rewrote the bill requiring women to seek an abdominal ultrasound. And Saturday Night Live has ripped it. The Daily Show has ripped it. The governor now has pulled his support for the initial bill. And you have, you know, people trying to get active and saying, no, 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 this is not okay. They show up. 900 people showed up, but still 31 people got arrested.
It's really insane, the assault on women's rights throughout the country. The only thing... that makes me happy is how much attention that this has gotten, because when this type of legislation was floated and passed in Florida, nobody even realized what was going on. Because as I said, it came in the form of a piece of legislation entitled the Health Reduction and Simplification of Healthcare Act. And it was, in my opinion, beyond the vaginal ultrasound, beyond the abdominal ultrasound with a full exam, right, requiring a physician to, right, physically use his hands to, right, you know, and go look up the definition of rape.
Right, exactly.
I mean, if you're going to sit here and tell me that that's not forcing a woman to be raped, I'm sorry, you can't read very well.
When I was prepping the show and everything, I was like, I don't want to talk about it other than to say that I'm just offended as what I would consider a decent human being, or someone that tries to be a decent human being. I'm just offended by this in every way, you know, and I want to support the people and the activists who showed up and, you know, mention the ones who got arrested and say, I'm with you. Scott, what are we doing this weekend? We want to drive to the
What are you talking about? There's plenty of protests going on here.
Go get active and protest. There's so many protests
to go anywhere.
Talk
there's
about.
Tons going on downtown every day.
I want to say that I'm definitely with you, and I feel uncomfortable as a male talking about a topic that males should not be making final decisions on in any way whatsoever.
No authority to discuss it.
Right, and so I want to talk about the activism that's going on and bring about awareness. And
but it's about power. The overarching issue is about power.
Right.
I mean, it's about male dominance in a misogynistic society, and it's about power. And it's also an election year. So let's gin up some machismo and get some voters out.
The last time that Danielle was on the show with us, we did this brilliant expose on how we need a revolution of women. And if you missed the show, definitely go back to the website. You can watch all of our previous shows. Shameless plug. But it's just
the system is broken.
And that brings us to, if I can segue, that brings us to a question that I like to, because I'm a realist. I want to look at things how they really are and talk about things how they really are, and maybe we can really solve some really serious problems with real solutions. And how you start that thinking process is you ask the question, where is reality now? We see corporations have redistributed power. Oh, they don't like that word. Redistributed. Corporations have redistributed power away from we the people. Capitalism is no longer challenged.
Of course not.
And so what does this mean, Scott? This is one of your favorite topics. I'll give you an open forum here to open the conversation with.
Smurf, yeah!
So where is reality now as far as corporations in power? And are we challenging the right things? What does this mean?
Wait, where are you getting these questions from?
Well, this is from our show prep sheet.
All right.
This
is back on the show prep sheet.
We actually...
you did a lot of work on this, man.
Believe it or not, ladies and gentlemen, I put a lot of work into into the programs, even though my problem is I got so much to talk about and there's so many important things going on that I don't want to miss anything, and I'm just kind of scattered, as you can see me randomly throwing.
Well, there's all kinds of little issues, and they all devolve from the larger issue, and that's, you know, greed and corruption, and it's consistent throughout history. You know, there is the analogies of, I can always go back to Rome and Greece, and let's face it, kingdoms. I mean, everything, you know, it wasn't, what was it? There's a phrase, and I can't remember it, I'm not doing it to it justice, but I mean, it wasn't until a couple hundred years ago that we realized that, hey, monarchies don't work. Let's think of another kind of system of governance, you know? Something a little less hierarchical, if you will, you know, or at least concentrated power. But then again, when you're dealing with money, and capitalism is about money, you know, an exchange of money, then concentrated power works really well. Let's face it, that's how China has, you know, the best sweatshops in the world. So, because it's slave labor, you know, people are killing themselves because they don't want to work anymore, literally killing themselves rather than going to work again. You know, and that's what slave labor is, and that's how we have cheap iPads, and that's how we can afford to stay afloat economically, at least, you know, marginally afloat. But that too is waning, as you can see, what you talk about with the XL pipeline. You know, we're becoming, you know, a country that imports raw materials and exports finished goods.
Which is backwards of the way it's supposed to be.
Right. It is a third world country.
Theoretically.
And so, you know, we're a third world country. Well, not exactly. It works out that way if you're actually importing raw materials and exporting finished goods. But when it's oil and all you're doing is refining it, you know, you're the backyard, you're the refinery for the world. And so, I mean, that's just the only
dirt pit.
Yeah, that's the only manufacturing we got left. And so capitalism, when it becomes a supernatural state, when it takes over governments, the word of the day, if anyone can remember this, and I keep forgetting it, is inverted totalitarianism.
Oh, yeah,
Sheldon Wolin's quote, inverted totalitarianism. You know, classical totalitarianism, i.e., kingdoms, monarchies, dictatorships, etc., are when the economy is controlled by the government. You know, Russia, Soviet Russia, USSR, was totalitarianism. It wasn't even close to communism. You know, the government dictated everything, you know, including the economy. Well, inverted Sure. totalitarianism is when the economy dominates the government. And that's what you have. We have, you know, it's hidden behind the mask of the corporate state, which is all brought to you by friendly, howdy-doody the Lorax movie, you know, by people. That's just an example. By Madison Avenue, who generates propaganda, which is actually another word for public relations.
Pay no attention to that man behind the curtain.
Exactly, and so you have people outraged at a child's movie that has over 40 plugolas.
70.
I'm sorry, it was an obscene amount. Plugolas of corporate advertising in the middle of what is otherwise a child's animated cartoon. You know, I grew up on Dr. Seuss, and so it's really just disgusting.
There was an awesome. Oh, I'm sorry.
No, I was just saying. Wow, I didn't realize that movie had so many. So much, for lack of a better word, propaganda in it.
Yeah. Oh, that's propaganda.
Yeah, there was a brilliant tweet that I saw. It was reposted on Facebook. It went viral. It said words to the effect of, if Dr. Seuss found out that the movie had over that many, you know, advertising sponsors and brands for that movie alone.
Yeah, built into the movie.
He would be turning over in his grave so fast that we could harness the energy to power the earth or something. You know, it was...
Well, the Who's down in Whoville.
Right, exactly. But, yeah, you know, it's just using something like a Dr. Seuss movie to sell, was it a Mazda SUV looking thing?
It was a Mazda, it was a car. There's even Starbucks references in the movie.
Yeah, and it's just, it's so sad. And it's all about the money, you know? I mean, if you follow the money, the product placement is getting out of control because they're not generating revenue, and so they're looking for alternate...
Well, they are generating revenue, but the problem is when money is the only goal... And the goal of being in business is to make money, rather than to actually serve a purpose or a function. And money is an ancillary, benefit to it. Because let's face it, you're in business to do business, to make a living. You make a living, everyone else makes a living, and you make profit. But when that becomes the only goal, then the function of these institutions, whether it's the hospitals that need to make, X amount of dollars for their shareholders, and so people die. Or it's Wall Street, or it's, let's say it's the oil companies that need to make X amount of dollars more. And the other problem too is it's not enough to just maintain; you have to improve every year, and there's a limit. And I think with that model of constant improvement, so-called improvement of corporate money, there is no end. And the end is the planet stripped bare, and it was global warming, and we're dead.
Well, I think just to tie Scott what you're saying into Jacob's question of, is this the reality now? What is reality now? And it's the fact that people have accepted corporate. Oh, yeah. People have grown up now with corporate power. You have the 20s and 30s something that don't know anything else, that we've been, the Coca-Cola generation, the generation that have always had humongous and prominent corporate branding. And we've been taught from grade school to college that, profit is the sole goal of the corporation. And where some of us remember that in that discussion used to be stakeholders and shareholders, it has gone from that to solely, stockholders, shareholders, right, profit holders, where stakeholders used to be your surrounding environment, your employees, your distributors, your clients, your supply chain. And it used to be a symbiotic relationship that realized one couldn't function without the other, that profit couldn't be made by the corporation without employees that were willing and able and healthy enough to go to work. And all of that has changed, and profit has become the sole motivation. But the difference is the reality has become that people have accepted it. Yep. And we don't fight it because it's like the unwritten law that nobody says it. But of course, corporations are supposed to make a profit. What else are they there for? That's the mentality. Instead of, can't they make a profit and do something good for their surrounding community? Can't they make a profit and make all of their employees better off? Can't they make a profit and maybe provide health care to those who otherwise wouldn't be able to afford it? We know they can because they did.
Right. There was suddenly a time when that was the case.
Suddenly reality became that profit is the only motivator.
Well handled, sir. Well handled.
Amen.
And there you go.
That's awesome. Yeah, you're absolutely right. And then it's like what's cool now, some companies try and have the double bottom line where they make a lot of money as well as do good. But
and that's why you can get all of our podcasts for free at our website, because that was so dense that Scott, you lost me at some point.
Sorry.
And go back and re-listen to that because there was a lot of good in there. It's just up against the bottom of the hour here. I want to take a quick break. We'll be right back. We're going to continue the conversation. And can you finish this sentence? Annual blank spending reaches all-time high. Americans spent $51 billion on their blank in 2011. We'll be back. Filter-free radio.
The first known instance of a man who was killed because he had lousy ratings.
Disappointed yet again by Sunday morning political talk shows brought to you by the mainstream media? Don't let them ruin your Mondays.
Sounds like somebody's got a case of the Mondays.
There's a fresh way, a filter-free way, to jumpstart your news week. On Monday nights, come experience Jacob Dean, host of Filter Free Radio.
He is the most interesting man in the world.
Finally, there's a radio talker who will arm you with the real facts, all the facts, and guide you through the labyrinth of fake news and false punditry. Each week, Jacob Dean throws out all those worn-out memes, crystallizes important issues, champions progressive causes, and features constructive solutions. That's Filter Free Radio, every Monday night from 7 to 9 p.m. Eastern, on the Ustream home of Nicole Sandler, radioornot.com, and filterfreeradio.com, the official website of Filter Free Radio.
Weigh your options regarding hallucinations over the phone. No joke. It's a penny for your thoughts, a dime for your mind. No one cares if Satan is in the smokestacks or that electric spiderwebs are weaved by the lampposts. You may have figured out how many licks it takes to get to the center of a Tootsie Pop, but that doesn't give someone a job or comfort them as they watch a street vendor set himself on fire during the local 9 o'clock news. Bahrain, Greece, Tahrir Square, UC Davis, Rio de Janeiro, Pakistan, Fukushima, Joplin, Oslo, Zuccotti Park, Syria, Oakland, Libya, Dorley Rainey, Christina Taylor Greene, Steve Jobs, Muhammad Wazizi, etc., etc., etc. This year hasn't been an illusion orchestrated by some sick, omnipotent magician. No trap doors or sleeves full of tricks or stupidity performed on television to increase some reject's net worth by 5%. You can't escape that the world is full of 7 billion humans and counting who we can't possibly feed, shelter, or protect. No amount of pills, plants, powders, or potables will make these facts vanish. Trust me. I've tried, and I still wake from dreams of Armageddon drenched in cold sweat. This is no time to be wrapped up in trivial pop star, vampire, bullshit, two-week marriages. Open your eyes and ears. Occupy your mind. Be here. Engage. Live for others, friend, family, or stranger. You can wrap yourself in blankets of manufactured pleasure parading as enlightenment. Go for it. But do not feel as if your uniquely uniform experience deserves a neon marquee text message or TV special on Discovery. No news means you're not paying attention, and the world will burn anyways.
Come experience the next generation of progressive voices on Nicole Sandler's primetime lineup at RadioOrNot.com. Liberate yourself with filter-free radio every Monday night.
The Occupy movement has nationally altered the conversation. And that's where it begins. The unthinkable has hijacked the conversation. If you look at the Occupy movement, when you say the word Occupy now, it means something completely different than what it meant 4 months ago. The national conversation can change itself into a new direction, and we need a new conversation. We need a new culture. We need to start the conversation.
Skepticism. You know, I chose that word skepticism not because it's related to cynicism. It's in fact the exact opposite of cynicism. Skepticism, by definition, means to question everything. You should always be skeptical, and you should always rely on the voices from below.
Tune in every weekday night to the primetime Radio or Not lineup at the Ustream home of Nicole Sandler, RadioOrNot.com.
For Representative Alan West, the skyrocketing price of gasoline is a personal pocketbook issue. The Florida Tea Party Republican, who blames President Obama for the price increase, recently wailed on Facebook that it's now costing him $70 to fill his Hummer. It's hard to feel the pain of a whining $174,000 a year Hummer-driving Congress critter, but millions of regular Americans really are feeling pain at the pump. It's an especially cynical political stunt, then, for Republicans and their chorus of right-wing mouthpieces to use gas price pain as a whip for lashing Obama's January decision to reject the infamous Keystone XL pipeline. Outrageous, they cried, asserting that Keystone would bring 700,000 barrels of Canadian tar sands crude per day through its 2,000-mile-long pipeline to refineries on the Texas Gulf Coast. More gasoline for America, they shout. Lower prices for consumers. What's not to like? Well, aside from inevitable environmental damage from pipeline leaks, being lied to is one thing we don't like. Their claim that this Canadian crude would be refined into fuel for our vehicles is a lie. Instead, the refiners intend to export it to Europe, Latin America, and China. The dirty little secret that Keystone backers never mention is that building it would not shave even a penny off the price we pay at the pump. Meanwhile, financial speculators and supply manipulators, who are artificially causing our gasoline prices to rise, escape scrutiny, while politicians, tanked up on big oils and Wall Street's campaign cash, divert attention to the bugaboo of Obama's pipeline decision. And yet again, our nation postpones the necessary investments in conservation, alternative fuels, and mass transit that will actually solve the gas gouging problem. This is Jim Hightower saying, what's not to like?
If you like these feisty pops of populism that Hightower zings out on the airwaves, check out the Hightower Lowdown. Jim's monthly newsletter provides the in-depth lowdown on what the greed heads of Wall Street and the boneheads of Washington are doing to us behind the scenes. With Hightower's saucy Texas humor and truth-telling populist perspective, the lowdown literally can lift you up. And get this, you can have the lowdown delivered to your mailbox or email each month for only $15 a year. Yes, 12 issues, only 15 bucks. Check it out, HightowerLowdown.org.
Here comes Jacob Dean on your computer screen with Skeptical Scott on Radio or Not. Filterfreeradio.com.
We're here live in our studio.
The school system that teaches to the test, sneaks the kids the answers, and still fails.
I don't need you. I got money.
I mean, I'm not the sharpest pencil in the pencil thing.
Rejected by society, huh? Well, why didn't you say so?
Maybe he's right. We are jerks.
You want I should spray some of my jerk off on you?
Hey, it's okay.
And welcome back to Filter Free Radio. We're broadcasting live. It is March 5th, 8:36 on the East Coast, and 5:36 on the West Coast. Thanks so much for joining us. And a big shout out and hello and welcome to all of our fine, awesome folks in the chat room, which I do have sort of open, half open. Danielle, Left Neck Chick, Shano, Adam, Brokehammer, JD Fishin', Johnny Double O, DJ Downtown, Ray Madero, Scooter Khan, Skeptical Scott, Snork Y2K, The Maestro, Will from Chicago, six guests and more in the new chat room, which I can get to in just a second, but I don't have open in front of me. So if you're hanging out in the new chat room, hello.
Just, me, Ray, and Will from Chicago in the new chat room.
Danielle
the VIP
saved it.
Room.
That's okay. Yeah. We are going to eventually start shifting folks to the new chat room.
Really?
It's still in the process of being worked out, and so you know we'll get there. I'm partial to the old chat room still for now, and so that's kind of where I was reading from.
Yeah.
So
well, it helps. It's on the page with the video. So,
but and also want to give a shout out to TalkRadio1.com and also ProgressiveBlendRadio.com. If you're giving us a listen there, check out our website, FilterFreeRadio.com. You can watch all of our previous episodes and check out Scott's blog. It's very informational, and I post some random stuff on there. I've got a cool video from Occupy DC of an aerial cam that was on a helium balloon in a fishing pool. Just go check out my blog, FilterFreeRadio.com.
And it's on the front page.
It will explain it all.
Well, and Adam Kuhn said you forgot him in the chat room. I didn't catch, but
Adam.
Hey, he wasn't there a second ago.
Hey, Adam.
He's kidding.
Oh, okay.
He's sneaky, that one.
Oh, Jacob Gullible's written on the ceiling. Oh, yeah, there. Oh, wait, no, that's not. I'm sorry.
And if you don't believe me, go fuck yourself.
That's my man. And also, welcome back to the program, the fine co-hosts of Talking Left, talkingleft.com, and follow them on Twitter at Talking Left, Chano and Danielle. Thanks, guys, for joining us.
Thank you.
It's been a blast.
I teased right before the break. Can you finish this sentence? A report, annual blank spending has reached an all-time high. Americans spent $50.96 billion on their blanks in 2011. Any people with the answer? Anyone think they got the answer?
Well, you added the S. I was going to go with porn, but I guess that's not it.
I was going to go with food.
It's not food. It's not porn. Good guesses. Scott?
Gasoline?
No.
Snork in the chat room says guns or Bibles.
Nope, it's not guns, not Bibles. It's not peanut butter. It's not credit card interest. The ladies and gentlemen, the answer is annual pet spending reaches an all-time high. Americans spent almost $51 billion on their pets in 2011.
That's because pets rule.
And that just cements something that I've been saying for a long time, is that's the more people I meet, the more I love my dog. And
you know what, Jacob?
Well handled, sir. Well handled.
I was going to play the George Carlin clip. I need to buy more stuff. So it takes my mind off of whatever. Well, spending money I don't have on stuff I don't need.
Spending money you don't have on things you don't need.
Right.
To delude yourself from how bad you're getting fucked by the system.
Yeah, you got that one memorized.
Sorry.
Give one of those things they buy for themselves when they're trying to take their minds off how badly they're getting fucked by the system.
There we go. Well done, Producer Scott.
Sorry, I didn't get
you
up fast enough.
You are the official producer, man. That's great.
I'm a little slow on the uptake.
Right before the break, we were talking about, I think, probably the most important topic or debate or discussion you can hear anywhere. Anywhere right now, and it's kind of stemmed from me from reading Death of the Liberal Class by Chris Hedges. It opens with a quote from George Orwell, quote, at any given moment there is an orthodoxy, a body of ideas, which it is assumed that all right, correct thinking people have accepted without question. Anyone who challenges this prevailing orthodoxy finds himself silenced with surprising effectiveness. A genuinely unfashionable opinion is almost never given a fair hearing, either in the popular press or in highbrow periodicals. End of quote. Yeah, that's kind of the whole mantra of my idea of this show and what I wanted to do and just kind of ultimately run with.
You wanted to be filter free.
Yeah, and God, because there's always so much happening in the news. It's like, you know, I read the newspaper. I clip out funny stories, and I go, oh, that's funny, and I'll highlight a couple sentences, and I'll clip out, you know, half a dozen news stories, and I'll scan the interwebs, and you've, by the end of the day, or by, you know, 6 o'clock, 7 o'clock on the East Coast, I've got 5 hours worth of stuff to talk about.
Yeah, and it's all related, though. If you put it all together like that, and you're able to actually look at that much news in one day, then after a while, you're like, oh, and here's how this is related to that, and here's why, and it really all comes down to money.
One of the topics that I wanted to talk about is like the university factor of the previous discussion and how students aren't really learning to think critically anymore.
I totally agree.
My co-eds, my fellow alumni of my age and younger, I can vividly remember definitely noticing this. People don't think critically anymore. I mean, just to examine or critique the system, the culture, political assumptions, things that they see on TV. I mean, whatever happened to this thing? Oh, don't believe everything you see or hear.
Yeah, you know, truth in advertising.
Right,
wasn't that a phrase?
I noticed in your show prep, Jacob, you referenced colleges. You know, academic universities not teaching critical thinking, but I think the problem is much more serious than that. With all of these test requirements in schools, you know, these kids have so much time learning the test, which is usually three subjects, math, science, reading. math, science, reading, math, science, reading. There's no critical thinking taught at all.
Nope.
Wait, I have the perfect clip. Are you going for it, Scott? I got it first.
The school system that teaches to the test, sneaks the kids the answers, and still fails.
You mean that one?
By the way, all these new drops are brought to you by the most recent Simpsons episode. The 500th episode is brilliant, by the way.
And this video will not be used for revenue sharing. And anyways.
The revolution will not be televised.
Yes, it will not. But it will be live.
On RadioOrNot.com and all of the adjoining great show websites.
It's online, baby.
And in your mind.
That's right.
Yeah. The kids aren't learning to think critically anymore, being a kid. The kids, you kids.
Oh,
kid, get off my lawn!
In my day.
Downhill both ways.
They've become like a breeding ground for managers, system managers, to train and serve what Scott would call the corporate culture and economic state, right?
You mean the inverted totalitarianism?
Right. That word.
Otherwise known as the corporate state, or some people would call it a corporatocracy.
And that's a term coined by
Sheldon Wolin.
And you have always videos of him featured on your blog,
right?
Oh,
yeah, there's a Sheldon Wolin video on our blog about the horizontal democracy.
There you go.
He says all our current democratic institutions are fundamentally anti-democratic because hierarchy in its nature is anti-democratic. And all of our institutions are hierarchical. So.
And if they can bring along another generation of mediocre students, they're much easier to control. If they were to breed excellence, you would have kids that would want to actually, you know, excel and be part of that, what they think is their pie that they want to keep for themselves. So if you can breed a whole, you know, bunch of people who just do the menial tasks, and they can sit there as new corporate monarchs and lord over them.
Got to get their slice of the Occupy.
What?
Okay, never mind.
I got it.
Anyways.
Hi.
Okay, wow. Tough crowd tonight. Thanks, Danielle.
I'm with you, man.
I'm here all night.
I'm sorry, I didn't get that. I'm a little slow.
No, it's all good. So that brings me to another question. So, I like to think of us as being people who are dedicated to, values. Like real, you know, truth and honesty and these things, values, virtues, you know.
Common decency.
Yeah, those things. Can a life of dedicated to values possibly be realized inside a commercial civilization where everything is...
Everything has a monetary value.
Everything is exploited and exhausted to the point of extinction, you know. As just a mere commodity to profit? Yeah. I mean,
that's always my biggest struggle, and it has been for over a year and a half now, I guess, when I was like, all right, can we just reform capitalism? Can we just reform our democratic structure? And can we, you know, roll back, put in place all the restrictions that came with the New Deal that allowed capitalism to flourish, you know, with all the, I guess, what do you call it, structures, if you will. Or is the fundamentals of the system so bad that no matter what you do, eventually you leave in place? Which is the argument that I always hear, is that even if you reform the system, you still leave in place the motivational factor of money. Money is always the motivator in capitalism. And if that's always the motivator, then eventually there are the people who do succeed the most are the ones who do the most harm, because that's your only goal. You know, people be damned, world environment be damned, let's make the most money. And and you can externalize all the expenses and internalize all the profits, and that end up, you know, the monopoly game, when one person has all the money and we're all broke and that's it. And so that's really the final game, I think, of capitalism. And that's, how do we break that structure, and how do we reform the system into something that benefits all of us while not afflicting others, and while not rewarding those who do better with exorbitant, you know, with something that's in balance, I guess, with the rest of society. I mean, you know, how rich is too rich, not just how poor is too poor. And so how do you find that balance?
I'm not saying that we have all the answers. I'm just saying that we're having the right discussion.
I got all the questions. I got a million questions.
Well, I think that there's the human or maybe civilizations, I guess, just a habit of wanting there to be values. So we've commercialized things that we typically saw having values, like religion, like church. Those are now profit-making industries. You know, we've added the profit motive to where simply the values should have been. And I don't know that I see where the room is for real, true values anymore. And except the one place I think that they can exist is personal relationships, is your family, your friends, you know, learning that when you piss somebody off or when you break their trust or when you are a really good friend, what outcome that has in your life. And I know it's a strange segue, but I think things like teenagers and children sitting on a video game system for 10 hours a day instead of building those personal relationships is going to be more harmful to our value system than commercialism could ever be.
Absolutely. Well, you're talking. Amen.
Yeah.
Where do I do
yeah,
that?
Come on. Come on.
I don't have it.
Producer,
I don't have an amen.
All right.
I got to get an amen drop.
You have to find your own.
I bet it's in Kenny Picks. I bet it's in some of Kenny Picks drops that I haven't had a chance to go through.
We'll get there.
but absolutely. I mean, I totally agree. And what you're saying is, and then I lost my train of thought when I was looking for the applause button.
That's okay.
That's Scott.
Yeah. Can you make your point again?
This brings me to a really good quote from Chris Hedges that I saved in the show prep sheet for you, Scott. He says, quote, "Years devoted to the study of ethics, justice, and morality prove useless when it comes time to stand up to corporate forces that usurp religious and moral language for financial and political gain," end quote.
Right, you reward sociopaths.
Right.
And there was a statistic, what's that poll that came out last week?
And that's why, I mean, Wall Street exploded and...
Yeah, that was the news last week where they said there's, I think, something like 10% of people who work on Wall Street or within Wall Street tested on a much higher scale for sociopathy than the rest of society. I guess the rest of society averages
one in ten.
Yeah, 1 in 10. So that's 10. That's 10%.
Where in normal society it's 1 in 100.
It's 1%, right? So the rest of society is 1%, but 10% of Wall Street has sociopaths working for it. Why is that? Because that's exactly what capitalism is. It's a sociopathy where money rules, and if you can make the most money, then you win. And everyone else be damned. It's a disconnect. It's what you were talking about earlier, Jacob. How do you impart upon somebody the disconnect, or what's otherwise known as hypocrisy, that people have, that they deny themselves from? You know, they live in denial and live in the illusion.
And when I was talking about that, my whole point was you can't tell somebody they're wrong. They have to see it themselves, and it has to. It's like if you've ever seen the movie Inception. It's really that whole part where they have to kind of make it themselves.
Yeah,
that's how it works. That's how it will stick in your brain.
You can't tell a person to think this way. They have to discover for themselves how to think that way. So how do you plant the Inception?
Right. I'm not saying that movie is like
mind control or anything.
That
makes a valid point.
Well, but I mean, Fox News. Cable channel has the most viewers on cable, so there's something to be said for mind control and numbing propaganda.
Well, that's the notion of what you talk.
That was a horrible joke gone wrong. I'm sorry. fail.
But what you're talking about though is like the with the death of the liberal class and the institutions, like obviously the media is the biggest one, and we've shifted from no one reads anymore. In fact, I think the average individual is largely functionally illiterate because they don't read. I mean, no one sits down and reads anything more than a menu. You know, I know I don't. But the point is that when you shift to an image-based society, like what you're talking about, Danielle, that's what I reminded me of, was kids are playing video games. You know, they're disconnected from other people, and they don't read, and they're not in touch with other people's emotions. It's all image-based. And so, you know, people are confused by the way they're made to feel with actual thought. And so people are like, oh, I feel this person is such and such, rather than I know or I've thought about it and read about it and done some research, you know. And so you have people who walk around.
The Constitution is going to be a picture book.
Exactly. So. And so that's the basis for their interaction with human beings. And that's just a horrible way to live. And so
wasn't that a Herman Cain line, something about I'm going to read more than a page or something like that. Who was that?
No, every bill is going to be 3 pages. Or
yeah,
something.
There was something about that was kind of funny. And when you referenced, you know, picture book, I was like, hey,
yeah,
I like picture books.
But Danielle, you made a valid point though, and that's that. We have an entire generation of people
that have no social skills and no understanding of values.
Exactly, and then they're just completely disconnected from what is real.
They're actually literally trained to go and blow stuff up.
Oh, absolutely.
You don't think that was engineered? I mean, I know that I'm the conspiracy theorist. Scott may be with me on this one, but you don't think there was some...
That's
some,
not a conspiracy theory. That's...
You know,
what?
Engineering there. Oh, how do you build a whole generation of soldiers? You get them really hooked on going and blowing stuff up and having no social or morale.
Even if that so-called theory, if you will, isn't true... The fact of the matter is we have such a large military-industrial complex that all these games that are now games for sale on PlayStation, et cetera, were military training games designed for the military to desensitize them to war. And so as a little ancillary benefit, oh, my God, we can sell these to people, to real everyday people. They can play, and we can make money. And also, it turns out we have a generation of people who, you know, are warmongers.
It just makes me kind of think that, Jacob, your original question of how do you have values in the, you know, in the commercial society,
right. It's,
I don't think any of us know, but maybe we can start trying to figure out how to reinstitute them.
Yeah. And just talking about it. That's my whole thing is I'm definitely upfront about the fact that I do the show and we have a lot of fun and we put a lot of thought and a lot of work into it. I'm not claiming to have any answers, let alone the answer or a answer or a logical answer.
I don't even know my name.
Heck, I don't even know where I live.
That's the one.
No, but bad. We need the drops.
Sorry, man.
But my point is just starting the conversation is where it starts. And we played that promo about, you know, you just simply start talking about it and then you start thinking about it. And then we're thinking about, you know, something that could bring about a real solution or a real change to really benefit a whole bunch of people rather than a reality TV show that's having, you know, celebrity superstars. But it's just as irrelevant as gossip on the Jersey Shore. It's garbage.
Yeah, you have to force critical thought on people.
I wanted to end. We've only got a couple minutes. I would definitely want to give everybody a couple minutes to wrap up final thoughts. I wanted to play a really quick clip. I had a whole bit lined up, and we didn't get to it. And it's not worth much more than 30 seconds, but this particular clip was done by The Daily Show. Samantha Bee was interviewing Grover Norquist, the guy who's got everyone on grid... I can't even say it.
Capitol Hill gridlock.
Thank you. Because of the tax pledge, right?
Yes.
Listen to this. He actually admits that he made this up in seventh grade when he was 12 years old, probably because he was bullied or something. That's beside the point. Listen to this.
My team is winning. I think you need to talk to Harry Reid. He wanted a $2.5 trillion tax increase last year, and he didn't get it.
Your team is winning? It's like you came up with this whole idea when you were 12.
It was something I came up with when I was 12 because we had a... teacher.
I'm sorry, what did you say? You came up with this idea when you were...
Seventh grade.
In seventh grade.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, the entire federal government is paralyzed because of a document written by a 12-year-old in 1968.
There's a whole 5-minute piece, and she totally rips him, and it's so funny and revealing and like, wow. But anyways, I just wanted to share that as kind of a funny... note to end
it's
on.
It's funny and frightening.
Just mad he got picked last in dodgeball.
As was I.
You not picked me last in dodgeball.
If you can dodge a wrench, you can dodge a ball. What was that? There's a whole movie.
Dodgeball.
Thank you. Talking left. Danielle and Chano, I wanted to give you guys a couple of minutes to plug and you know, even though we know that I mentioned earlier, or you mentioned that it's going to be a best of show, I still want to mention the website and everything and Twitter and
final thoughts.
Yeah, final thoughts.
You know, this Wednesday is best of. Next, the week after, Laffy will be on from Public Carnival, and Catherine Cryer will be talking.
Excellent.
So we're looking forward to that very, very much. But so... You know, tune in this week because we'll put all the good stuff on.
Yeah, all those interviews you joke about, Bill Press and John Fugelsang and you know, Carl
Joe,
because
I'm jealous.
You could get all those people too, Jake.
Come on, producer Scott, work.
Yes, Scott, become a booker.
No.
Not a bookie. Booker.
Right.
It's, you know what? Sometimes you have to continue to reach for the stars to actually touch them once in a while. And you have to ask, and you get a lot of no's, but eventually you get some yeses.
That's amazing. That's well put.
Yeah, that sounds good. That sounds like a lot of work, though.
It's a lot of work. Thankfully, and I give full and total credit to Shane.
Okay. Scott, sorry. Final thoughts, bud? Or?
Huh?
Final thoughts? You're, you know... This is what we're going to leave everyone with for 7 days before we come back and say something else.
Oh, well, then go to the video blog and on filterfreeradio.com and check out the, my personal favorite is Chris Hedges' lecture on Death of the Liberal Class.
Yes.
I mean, I've watched it several times. And then there's another video on there called Let Your Life Be a Friction to Stop the Machine. Another really good video to watch. And so it's all good educational material, and it's the stuff I pull from. And take the time and look at it. Filterfreeradio.com.
If you actually go looking for the significant conversations on things that really do matter, you will find them. And I suggest you check out RadioOrNot.com, TalkingLeft.com, KennyPick.com, FilterFreeRadio.com, ProgressiveBlendRadio.com, also TalkRadio1.com. And everybody else who helps make this show possible, thank you, Nicole Sandler, Roy Burt at CrownedRecords.com, DanoSongs.com. And, you know, remember, it starts with the conversation. And as long as we're talking, you know, the right conversation, we'll eventually end up in the right direction. Maybe. It's just a thought. But we got to try something different because what we're doing right now isn't working, clearly. Right? So we'll see you next week, Monday. 7 o'clock Eastern Time, filterfreeradio.com. Just click on Watch Live and Chat Live, and that's where we are. We'll see you next week. Revolution is the solution, but you can't spell revolution without love. So get out there and love. Spread the love.
Yeah.
See you next week.
Well, you know, that's just like your opinion, man.
This is it.
There's a time when the operation of the machine becomes so odious, makes you so sick at heart, that you can't take part. You can't even passively take part. And you've got to put your bodies upon the gears and upon the wheels, upon the levers, upon all the apparatus, and you've got to make it stop. So give me something to believe, 'cause I am living just to breathe. And I need something more to keep on breathing for. So give me something to believe.
You're listening to Jacob Dean, streaming live on the web.
The revolution will be broadcast.
We bring you the real stuff.